Thank you very much. Excellencies, distinguished guests, it's a true honor for me to be here tonight to share a little bit of my experiences, of our experiences with you on counterpiracy. As you can see in the title of my presentation, Together Successful. And I hope that that is something that you will remember on the end of all the lectures. The only way we can be successful is if we do it together. This is the general outline of the presentation. I'll quickly go through that. Try to keep up with the time, of course. Piracy hurts us all. And not everybody knows that, but it does hurt us all. Not everybody is aware of that. Let's have a little look at the joint operating area, where we are fighting this problem. And that's only one part of the world where piracy is, but that's where I've been. If you see the area, you see the mainland of Europe projected into it, and basically Europe fits in twice, because there are already piracy east of the Maldives. It's a very important region. 27 nations, of which 14 with a coastline, but also fragile states, and very important choke points, like in the north, the Strait of Hormuz, of course, the beginning of the Gulf of Aden, the Strait of Bab al-Mandeb, and the end of the Gulf of Aden. It's a huge area, it's really very big. It's like if you have a problem in Oslo, you call the police in Madrid, and of course they will respond, but with around 55 kilometers an hour, so it can take 2-3 days before they're there. A lot of energy goes through it, a lot of containers, and about 23,000, 25,000 ships pass through the Gulf of Aden every year. So the area is relevant. And a lot of these ships, for instance, go to Rotterdam, but also to other main ports, not only in Europe, but also to the United States. As I said, it hurts everybody, it hurts the world. And not only in money, it's an economy problem. 7 to 12 billion, some think tanks have estimated. It hurts the main shipping routes, as I said, and of course, it also hurts Africa very badly. If you look at the activities, for instance, in the port of Mombasa, it is lower than it was. And it's not only Kenya that's involved, but also the mainland, the landlocked countries behind it that really suffer from piracy. Ask people from the Seychelles how they are hurt by piracy. Used to be at least 100 cruise ships a year. Now it's 1 or 2. They depend on tourism, but they also depend on their supplies over the sea, because through air it's really way too expensive. And very important thing is the hostages. At this moment, as we speak, and I had to adjust the slide this morning, because yesterday the Olip G was released, so it's now 6 merchant vessels in the hands of pirates, with around 120 hostages. But every merchant vessel that is in hands of pirates is one too many, and every hostage is one too many. If we would put here in the metropole or any cinema theater in The Hague 120 people being held hostage, it wouldn't take a week and somebody would take action. There people are held under horrendous circumstances for sometimes 1.5 years. They're being tortured, they're being beaten up, they're being raped. It is really terrible. No medical care, bad food, not enough water. I've spoken to one of the captains of these ships that was released. It's a horrible story. And these are only the big ships that we know of. There are numerous dhows with Iranians, with Pakistani, with Indians and other nations that are being held hostage. There's no money to be gained by holding a dhow, so they use the dhow as a mothership, and they also treat the crew very badly. And it concerns about 20 nationalities. On the bottom, you see the latest ship that was hijacked only a week ago, the Enrico Ievoli, an Italian ship. Unfortunately, not well protected, no best management practices, no citadel, no strong room where the crew could hide and stay for a few days until the Navy could come to their rescue. Let's talk about a little bit about the threat. The threat is widespread in the Gulf of Aden, the Arabian Sea and the Somali Basin, the Indian Ocean in front of Somalia. It used to be Some time ago, single skiffs coming from the beach trying to attack a merchant ship. Or sometimes human smugglers who brought Somali people, men, women and children, sometimes 80 people in one skiff, to the other side, to Yemen. They drop them on the beach, they come back, they loiter in the middle and they wait for a merchant ship. When the international community became very effective in protecting the IRTC, you can also see that on your flyer where that is in the Gulf of Aden, then we saw more pirate attack groups, and we saw them operating with whalers. Whalers are smaller boats with an inboard engine. Skiff has an outboard engine. I'll give you some pictures in a minute. And they were towing the skiffs, the attack skiffs. But we've also seen pirate attack groups operating from previously pirated motherships, from pirated merchant vessels, like for instance the very large crude carrier, the Irene SL, a supertanker, 333 meters long, 60 meters wide, 2 million barrels of crude oil, and they used it as a unit to attack other ships. But we see more and more the dhows that they use to operate from. Here's a picture, most of you will probably know it, of one of the attack skiffs. It's a Yemeni type, very fast, normally two outboard engines or one very powerful one, or Yamaha. Might dig into that later, but they're very effective. Here we see two examples of the PAGS, pirate attack group in a whaler, as I said, a little bit bigger boat with an inboard engine. They used to have lots of drums of fuel in it, but they get smarter and smarter. And now we see whalers with a double bottom, with 1,500 liters of fuel in a double bottom, with the weapons concealed in hidden compartments on the side. The ladders are not on top, but they tow it under the whaler. So it becomes more and more difficult for us to distinguish who is an innocent fisherman, because there are many of them there, and who is really a pirate. And this is what we see most, the dhows. You have the Yemeni type dhow on the bottom, and the more Iranian type dhow on top. In front, you see the hostages in the ellipse, and you see two guys with Kalashnikovs pointing at these hostages. Difficult to take action, but sometimes if you are really persistent and determined, you can be successful. And on the other dhow, you see the orange tarpaulin that tries to cover the attack skiffs and the outboard engines. But of course, we quickly see through that. And the ultimate mothership, this is an example, the motor vessel Polar. Two attack skiffs on the deck, and she was very, very active in trying to get other merchant ships. And especially when they just started, they were quite successful, because a merchant ship doesn't expect another merchant ship to have pirates with skiffs on board. What's our present response? And the present response is something we will also continue. But what is basically our present response? It is a comprehensive approach. As I said, working together to achieve the task of trying to stop the piracy. We coordinate very well between NATO, the European Union, and the Combined Maritime Forces, a group of countries led by the United States from Bahrain. I was honored to lead the NATO operation, but also the EU and the CMF operation. We talked every day with each other, we exchanged views, and we exchanged units. We got aircraft from the EU, maritime patrol aircraft, to have a closer look at certain areas. We were providing ships to them to assist, for instance, in protecting World Food Program. Every day we chatted, every day we coordinated, and it went very, very well at sea. But also coordination with the independent deployers. I've just met, before this meeting, I met a lot of people from China. China is there, very actively, very well prepared and doing a great job. The Russians are there, the Koreans, the Japanese, even Iran is there doing counter-piracy. Very important to coordinate with them, that we work together and not go for the same target at the same time. Another thing that's important is to de-conflict and cooperate with the regional national authorities. I've just given some examples, but there are a lot of countries in the region. But Djibouti is important. UAE, Oman, Yemen, they are very important. important for support, important because they have ports, they have logistical hubs that we can use, but also important because of their coast guards and their navies that we have to work with together to try to find a common ground. Another issue that we are doing is key leadership engagement with Somali authorities, especially with Puntland. Puntland is very active. They really want to kick these pirates out. And if you look at, for instance, the website of Somalia Report, you can see how active they are and what they are doing. They are really trying to get somewhere. What is important is that if we engage them, that we also come with some deliverables and not only talk. I've met a few times with Puntland authorities, and they said, well, you're a very nice man, but you're a little bit blah, blah, blah people. You only talk and you give us nothing. We want airstrikes, like in Afghanistan. Why don't you shoot these pirates off the beach? Of course, you can explain that it's not the way we do things, but anyhow, they do have a point, I think. Also important, of course, and part of the exit strategy is building capacity in the region. For instance, with Tanzania or Kenya, or the Seychelles. But building capacity is a long-term commitment. It cannot be done only by a naval ship with great sailors and great teams that just visits a port for a few days and does an exercise and gives some lectures and then goes again. We need liaison teams in those countries that take care of long-term commitment. Because you can give them brand new patrol boats, but if the engine breaks down and they don't know how to repair it, this brand new patrol boat will be in port and will never be used again and will be stripped for everything they can use. And I think it's important to improve the situational awareness in the maritime community, in the merchant community. I know Mr. Peter Prince is here from the Royal Society of Dutch Ship Owners. They are working very, very hard to accomplish this, but also the International Maritime Organization and other organizations are there, and we liaise with them to get a very good picture of what is going on and how to protect itself. Some results of the operation we had. We had a so-called focused operation. We put ships very close to the beach on the spots where the most active pirate camps were. And within this time frame, we had considerable successes. But again, it was a team effort. It was not only me or NATO or the staff or my team. It was a team effort by NATO, the EU, the CMF, but also the independent deployers. Together, we had great results. As you can see, we released a lot of hostages. Like recently, the Danish and the Americans have also been able to release hostages. And these are very happy people, having been for over a year in custody. We arrested 169 suspected pirates, and in some firefights where they started firing at us in self-defense, we had quite a few of these incidents. We killed 9 of them. We disrupted 12 of their motherships, and it was a big blow. They hadn't expected that. And of course, we took away a lot of their weapons, like rocket-propelled grenades, which is a very dangerous one. Of course, you all know the AK-47, the Kalashnikovs, but also M16, the American automatic rifle, hand grenades, even some explosives, the ladders, the fuel, all the stuff. We took it all away from them. And sometimes people say, are you not very frustrated that when you take all this stuff and there's not a case that you have to release them? Well, I'm not going into too much of the legal stuff. That's for the other speakers. But no, it's not always so frustrated. The coast of Somalia is 3,000 kilometers long. And when we put them back on the beach, we don't put them on the beach where they came from. So they have a challenge. Don't worry about that. And yes, it might sound frustrated, but on the other hand, and it's the same in all our countries, if you don't have a clear case in front of a judge with clear evidence, then it's no use to go through all the trouble, and then the judge has to say, well, there's not enough evidence, we have to let them go. So you must be very careful and very sure you must have a good case to be able to prosecute them. And what is also, I think, a very important result is we had excellent cooperation, as I have said, and mutual understanding between all the players. Just an example of the interaction with the independent deployers. See the Russians, the Koreans, but also I already mentioned the Chinese, Japanese, A lot of people are there all because they are also hurt by the piracy. And if you combine your efforts and combine the forces in a smart way, you never have enough assets there, but if you do it in a smart way, you can really achieve something. Capacity building, this is an example with the Seychelles Coast Guard. They're very eager, they're willing to do things. The Seychelles is 95,000 people on about 115 islands. And they have to live from tourism. And they're very afraid that perhaps the pirates will take one of the islands where there's a nice resort with tourists who have a lot of money, a lot to spend. Their fishery is hurt. The trade is hurt. For instance, the LPG tanker York was captured by pirates, and the islands almost went without LPG for a while. They were building a new port by a dredging company, Jan de Nul from Belgium. The barge with the dredging material was hijacked, and there was a delay of about 6 months in building this new port. It really hurts them. So we've tried to exercise with them, even with the Marines. We have trained their boarding teams, so they are more able and capable to do things by themselves. Let's have a quick look at a future response. Of course, we will continue to do the things, as I have just mentioned, in the present response, but for the future. I think we should continue and even expand the comprehensive approach. I think, it might be a little bit on the political side, but I think we should try to do more with the region, with Puntland, with Somalia. We should engage more with them, and we should listen to them. Listen to the local people. They have the knowledge. They know who is who. They know exactly who the pirates are and where they are. And they know what's best for their country. And of course, you have to be careful who you do business with, but I think we can achieve a little bit more there. So we have to enhance our support for regional counter-piracy efforts, because in the end, that's where we want to be. We also have to be proactive. We have to be smart. We have to try to be ahead of them. What will be their next move? After June, about 5 more ships have been hijacked. That is not too much. They only have 6 ships now in custody. They might get a ransom for it, but it's not too much. We is also the merchant community who's protecting themselves better and better. We are becoming quite successful against the pirates. Doesn't mean that we can leave. No, because you're successful, you have to stay there. But what will be their next move? Are they going to take people from resorts like Lamu in northern Kenya? Are they going to have them, to kidnap them for ransom? I don't know, but we have to be proactive and to try to see what they are going to do. Because it's really seriously organized crime. It's not about innocent fishermen, etc. I think we also, and the EU has now taken the initiative to come up with a discussion, we should tackle the camps. We can do that, and we can tackle the motherships. I think we should go a little bit further in our actions. The UN has approved it, the TFG of Somalia has approved it, to go on land and tackle the camps. I think we should do that. And how does a camp look like? I don't know if many of you know how a pirate camp looks like, but it's like this in the slide. On the bottom you see the waterline. It is very close to the coast. We have counted about 700 barrels of fuel. We have counted about 20-25 skiffs on the bottom, these little white things, with all the outboard engines. We've seen ladders, we've seen SUVs, we've seen weapons and water. It's a camp, there are no civilians there, it's only the organized crime and the pirates. And I think, and I know that the discussion is still ongoing, it's a political discussion, but I think, and we have the means to do it, that we should go in trying to tackle camps ashore. Furthermore, enhanced information sharing. As I said, we have to do it together, then we can be successful. We have to break the barriers, for instance, between military information and more civilian information, like law enforcement, like Interpol, like Europol. But also between the military, we can do better in enhancing sharing information. Share information with the people of Puntland, with the TFG of Somalia, we can even do better there. And also the United Nations, especially the United Nations Office of Drugs and Crime, is very, very active there, very successful there in building prisons and helping to build a legal system. We should exchange more information. And finally, I am a strong believer in military vessel protection detachments. I know that the Netherlands has now responded in sending autonomous vessel protection detachments on the ships of the World Food Program, which means that they don't need a military escort anymore. So the frigates that were alongside this World Food Program ships can now actively go after the pirates. That generates more capacity. And force generation is a problem. We see, especially in Western Europe, we see budget cuts within the defense, we see navies that can be hurt, the whole defense are being hurt. On one way it's of course understandable, but then you need to be more proactive, and the units that you have, put them there where you need them. And not alongside a World Food Program ship that only does about 10 kilometers an hour, which takes days to go from Mombasa to Mogadishu to Bosaso in the north of Puntland. Put a VPD on that and the ship can be used to better means. I know there's a lot of discussion about private security companies. I'm not going to say too much about it, perhaps in the discussion later. There are about 200 companies that are calling themselves private security companies. Some of them are really very good and well organized. But I must say a lot of them are sort of cowboys at sea. And they are not very well disciplined. They shoot at everything they see. And they also shoot at innocent Yemeni fishermen or other people. So it's a very difficult discussion, and I fully understand the position of the ship owners. But you have to be very, very careful who you deal with, because there are a lot of cowboys out there, there's a lot of competition, and there are even some private navies now sailing around there with an old trawler or an old ship. They painted gray and put a machine gun on it. I don't know everything about legal aspects, but for me, it's not a good development, a good situation. And of course, we see in other areas in the world, like West Africa, where there's a lot of armed robbery, where it's also a very dangerous area, and that might be something to think about also for the future. Furthermore, we will continue, especially as the Netherlands, to deliver ships, even a submarine, to tackle the pirates, and we will have a new commanding officer of the Operation Ocean Shield from June onwards. In summary, I think naval forces do make a difference, not only the ships at sea, but also the submarines beneath the surface, the aircraft in the air, and especially also the unmanned aerial vehicles. Together, also with the support from the land, we do make a difference. Cooperation, communication, and networking are the key to success. That's also why I think it's a long-term commitment. We have to stay there for a long term to build trust and confidence among each other, and then we can really achieve the ultimate goal. I'm not an optimist that piracy will be completely withdrawn from the world. We have already heard that it is one of the oldest crimes there is. I don't think we will achieve that, but I do hope that we can achieve a lot and make that area and perhaps other areas in the world much more safe for our innocent seafarers and for our economy. Thank you very much for your attention.